our program, human security program called HSP, which was established in US Tokyo almost 16 years ago, 2004, I think, in Komaba campus. This is a very significant project for this university. We try to struggle in the reality of the human security not just research and education, more kind of practical sort of a issue to be tackled. So in such a way, we are very much involved in this human security issues from a very variety of expertise, interdisciplinary course. Some of them also coming from Myanmar, the refugees, and they are willing to promote democracy, but because of the recent turmoil, it's very difficult. And so human security is now the very much concern in that country. And this is also our concern for human security studies. And then we just to focus Myanmar current situation. So we should learn from the especially the keynote speakers, High Excellency Zima. I don't know, she's a bit late in arriving, but anyway, hopefully she will come and to address situation in Myanmar updating. Then the panelists in the second part consisted of the international political science and regional studies in Myanmar and ASEAN, as well as some experts of the business and human rights. Make a comments and do also some kind of presentation, have a kind of a debating the situation. Then we open some floor to ask question. The question we address the each presenters through this Q&A function. Unfortunately, because of the security, we couldn't open up so much. It's just kind of be cautious for secure the privacy and so on. I hope you understand it. We intended not to commit any propaganda for the political, because of sensitivities. As an academia, we should just try to analyze very objectively and neutral position. But we try to address, especially the civil society in Japan, because Japan is quite a key partner of the this human security in the world. And especially the human security program is a focal point of the university for address this. As academia, we should what to do. What do you think? So that is our intention to organize it. Okay, thank you very much for we open the session. First one is a panel keynote speak. But before that, I'd like to introduce our dean. Professor Takumi Moriyama for the opening speech. Thank you very much. Please, Moriyama-sensei.
Hi. Colleagues and friends, my name is Takumi Moriyama, and I am Dean of the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences of the University of Tokyo. I am also a cultural anthropologist, and I have been studying the cultures and societies of Madagascar since 1988. As an anthropologist, I always ask myself how anthropological knowledge can be related to the reality of the people to which it refers and what it can bring to the life of the people being studied. Of course, as academic knowledge, anthropological knowledge must grasp the real aspects of the people concerned, and in so doing, construct models of reality. It is important to note, however, that reality and the meaning of reality are not the same, and that if you examine the question of how the people concerned understand and interpret the reality, you will have to take into consideration the different meanings for different persons according to their different social, political, economic, religious, and moral positions. Thus, we have to remember not only that real facts and real events constitute reality, but also that the meaning the people concerned invest in those facts and events from the various positions also form a large and important part of reality. It is a complicated situation, but anthropology as an academic endeavor has the mission of capturing this complexity and of clarifying the multifocality of reality. I would be most grateful today if the speakers and participants in this symposium can give us, on the one hand, visions of what has actually been happening in Myanmar, visions of the real facts and real events following the coup d'etat, and on the other hand, visions of what those facts and events mean to the people of Myanmar, regardless of whether they live in Myanmar or abroad, visions of how people in different positions understand and interpret events and facts differently. This should provide all of us with a great opportunity to deliberate on models of the reality that Myanmar lives in today. But my concern about the use of academic knowledge, including anthropological knowledge, is not only about the construction of models of reality, but also about the construction of models for reality. That is to say, models for another reality that could overcome the actual reality that Myanmar lives in now. What anthropological knowledge or academic knowledge in general would contribute to the resolution of the present confused situation in Myanmar? Is it possible for academic knowledge to construct models along the lines of which a different reality could be realized? Academic knowledge, including anthropological knowledge, is inevitably involved in these questions. Questions about how we can build a future society, how we can bring about a better life, and how we can maintain our hope. I would also be very grateful to the speakers and participants in this symposium if you can inspire us with some insight into these issues as well. Thank you very much for your attention.
Well, thank you very much, Dean Professor Moriyama. Very kind words and encouraging message, also the, based on the very good analysis of the situation and reality of Myanmar. Okay, so let's start the keynote speech by Her Excellency Zimma Aung, not yet arrived. So maybe unfortunately, I don't know what happened to her, but we already recorded her message anyway in a rehearsal a few days ago in case as a back. Record, unfortunately. So I think Haru-san will be taking care of that. Just we streaming this recorded voice message. In case she arrive in time, I can also open up for her to have some brief message. But anyway, meanwhile, we cannot wait for her for more than that. Let's review her message and record it in a few days ago. Yeah.
That will be the, you know, overview of the military coup deterrence. How was, you know, how was affect the human security of our people? And then what is, you know, NUG is standing for and the for the sustainability of the development and democracy. And our future plans, and then also request for the international community is just briefly. So what I would like to know is that it's just only for the my keynote speech, right? Not for the Q&A.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Correct. Okay. So I will take around the 15 to 20 minutes. Is it okay?
Yes. Right.
Okay. So. First and foremost, allow me to extend my gratitude to the government of Japan and the parliamentarian and the Japanese people for being a long-standing friend of Myanmar in our journey to democracy, sustainable development, and national reconciliation. Actually, Japan has always shown up for the people of Myanmar during the darkest periods of our history, providing humanitarian support and helping us find solutions to our issues while respecting our sovereignty. Japan has opened its doors since 1990s to Myanmar's nationals fleeing the military's persecutions. In 2012, Japan's waived Myanmar's $3.72 billion debt and resumed development aids after a 25-year freeze. This has significantly helped Myanmar as it was open to the world after years of isolation. Japanese journalists risk their lives to help the voices of our people be heard. At times when the military hunter attempts to silence pro-democracy movements. I acknowledge the bravery of Mr. Yuki Kitazumi, an independent journalist who was arrested by the military hunter last April. I also want to express my appreciation to the Nippon Foundations, Sasakawa Peace Foundations, and especially Mr. Yohei Sasakawa, the Special Envoy of the Government of Japan for National Reconciliation in Myanmar, for all the support on development, humanitarian, and peace process fronts. As the Foreign Minister of the National Unity Government of Myanmar, and as a parliamentarian, human security is at the core of my obligations to the people. But sadly enough, I cannot fulfill that obligation as a parliamentarian because of my own human security has been at risk. I have been running and hiding and away from my home since the 1st February. So have my fellow parliamentarians. As you know, since the military took power illegally, they arrested my fellow MPs. By now, nearly 900 civilians are killed, thousands injured or arbitrarily detained. Among them, many politicians. Therefore, on behalf of the people of Myanmar, I'm grateful for Japan for being a partner in fulfilling these obligations. It has been 5 months since the military hunter illegally seized power from a democratically elected civilian government. For those who are following the turn of events from a distance, it is essential to remember and always be grounded with the fact that the current instability in Myanmar and the region result from the military leaders' self-vested interests. Contrary to the hunter pretext of electoral fraud, Senior General Min Aung Hlaing and his co-conspirators, Eliger and Phil Cope, is motivated by their desire to protect their political and economic interests. The November 2020 elections were a promising step towards a democratic future for Myanmar. But the military illegally snatched away the chance for progress. They did so in plain sight of the entire world. And so far, They are getting away with it at great cost to both the human security of people of Myanmar and the hard fought for laws and norms that should govern the international system. The military is supposed to be an institution that protects its people. However, the military hunter has turned into terrorist force, and the violent threat to Myanmar's democracy and people's sense of security. It consistently uses its classic strategy, like excessive force and fears, in its attempts to control the country. They are terrorizing their own people, and the horrifying acts committed by the military are consistent with past atrocities committed by them against people of all ethnicities and religions who are living in Myanmar. Not only did they turn into the threat to human security of its own people, they also turned their violent threat to foreigners and diplomats living in Myanmar. On April 17, members of the coup regime's armed forces stormed the residence of Japanese foreign ministry diplomats and JICA staff in Yangon. It is a blatant violation of the Vienna Charter on international diplomatic relations, which is extremely dangerous to those from foreign diplomatic missions living in Myanmar. However, it has failed as the whole countries continue to resist the illegal military rule, despite the high risk that come with it. The hunter is losing. It doesn't have effective control of the country. Nevertheless, the hunter is leading Myanmar into a crisis amidst the global pandemic. People are starving, our economy is failing, our healthcare and education systems are collapsing, and all basic services are being deprived. The UNDP predicted that approximately 27 million people of Myanmar will be living in poverty within a year. War crimes and crimes against humanity are being committed every single day. In addition to the atrocity it has committed against our brother and sister of the ethnic regions, Kayan, Kachin, Kayar, Shan, Mon, Rakhine, Chin states, and also Rohingya. The hunter has been dropping bombs on villages, burning homes in ethnic states, and slaughtering people, causing a massage of refugees. UNHCR has estimated that there are currently 1.2 million internally displaced persons fleeing from the military's violent campaign. As of the 3 July 2021, 5,086 people have been arrested, charged, or sentenced, and 819 people have been confirmed to have been killed by the military hunter. This includes the Japanese journalist Kijazumi Yuki, who was detained in April and sent to the notorious insane prisons and released 1 month after. The previous government's measures to control the illicit cross-border economy have been undermined by the hunter, making the region vulnerable to the proliferations of transnational crimes, drug trafficking, and additional risks of COVID-19 community transmissions. The military is not paying attention to the vaccinations against COVID-19. What is happening in our country reflects how undermining people's wills destabilize the nation's foundations. It is also important to remember that the 21st century global system is highly interconnected, and therefore what is happening in Myanmar inevitably impacts globally and regionally. Myanmar is home to vast natural resources and placed in a geopolitically strategic locations, given our access to the Indo-Pacific. Wealth generated from the country benefits our neighboring countries, but not our people. The military hunter has systematically in its laws and policy since the first coup in our history in 1962 to amass ill-gotten wealth while leaving the country divided and its people in poverty. The recent military coup has shown us what we need to do. This is our moment to change course, to go further. That is why the National Unity Government, NUG, of Myanmar was formed, to dismantle the system that perpetuates the gates of insecurity, injustice, and instability. Our legitimacy derived from the people of Myanmar, and that have overwhelmingly rejected by the unlawful actions of the military junta. The NUG is established to serve and protect the people and establish peace, democracy, and equality in the country. Our government is not just only seeking for power, but to establish a process that leads to a constitutional reforms, elections, and fully representative government. Despite the limitations and complex challenge that we faced, the NUG is working very hard to lay down the foundations for transforming the country into a federal democracy anchored on the values and principles that serve, protect, and guarantee our people's core interest and security. We have dissolved the 2008 constitutions to ensure the complete transition of the military under the civilian rules and correct the instrument that legally and systematically marginalized and exploit our peoples for decades. We have enacted the historic 2021 Federal Democracy Charter in partnership with pro-democracy movement, such as ethnic M organizations, civil disobedience movement, civil society organizations, and political parties. The NUGs continues to coordinate with these stakeholders in the implementations of the charter. Our charter sets out our visions for achieving a democratic future for Myanmar. We will continue to consult with our constituency as we seek to develop and realize the visions set out within it. Human rights are an integral part of our Federal Democracy Charter and guide the work of our government. We fully intend to achieve equal rights for all citizens living in Myanmar. We are rebuilding the country piece by piece, brick by brick, by setting up people-centered policy and mechanism that will address the immediate needs of our people, while ensuring the rights of all the people in Myanmar are upheld and protected in a post-SAC Myanmar. We have been engaging with foreign governments and international organizations bilaterally and through multilateral platforms to ensure our efforts to bring Myanmar back under civilian democratic rules anchored on the international standards and norms. We must do more to change the situations and reverse the damage inflicted by the military. Our people deserve to live free from fear, oppression, dignity, and violence. At the very least, our people deserve to have decent meal and sleep at night with their families in their homes without worrying about being raided by security forces. We have endured long enough the military regime's consistent attack on our people's sense of physical, emotional, and economic security. It is time to change the course of history for Myanmar, and we need every possible help from the international community, including Japan, to achieve this. This is spirit we urge the Japanese government to continue its effort to pressure the military junta. At the same time, we also call on the Japanese government and the neighboring foundations to extend humanitarian assistance to those internally displaced people who have had to flee their home and villages to escape the atrocity of the military junta. Thank you so much for giving me the floor for this message to the world. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for Ms. Zim Woon. Unfortunately, she could not join the time list. We are a bit concerned about her security, probably from some information we cannot share, but she's safe, but because of security reasons, she must leave some place to relocate for avoiding any risks. So I'm afraid she would not come in time, but hopefully we can share some sort of information if possible to share. Anyway, So we have to move on the program without her, but I suppose our colleagues of the panelists can cover up any questions to the Her Excellency Ms. Zima Aung. So now I will close part one. Then part two, I will just ask panelists to discuss on 10 minutes each, followed by a question answer. So please, panelists, come to appear, to turn on the camera and on, and good. So first, I think Professor Michael Uchihara, she's coming in from abroad. I don't know where is she because the security is. Maybe she will just introduce herself. So 10 minutes, please start brief your introduction and your speech. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your kind introduction and also a very funny introduction, Dr. Sato. I would like to convey my sincere gratitude for Dr. Sato and all the professors and staff members at the Human Security Program of the University of Tokyo for hosting this much needed event. The assignment for me as a scholar of international relations and democracy support in particular is to talk about the moves of the international society regarding the Myanmar crisis. Given that I'm currently in the United States, I'm in Washington, D.C., as a visiting scholar at Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, I would like to shed light on Western moves on this front. I'm hoping that it serves to make comparison with Asian cases, which will be wonderfully explained by Professor Nemoto and Dr. Laxmana. After the coup in Myanmar, Western countries moved quickly. They promptly took steps to condemn the coup, imposed targeted sanctions on the military leadership, expressed their support for the committee representing Pidan Suphloto, or CRPH, as an electorally based parliament, and provide humanitarian assistance. A symposium on Myanmar hosted on May 20th by the Wilson Center, a US think tank, was symbolic. At the symposium, having Foreign Minister Zima Aung as the keynote speaker, US lawmakers and heads of democracy assistance foundations participated as panelists, and a strong message of support for democracy was expressed. Throughout the period, one issue that caused a headache for Western democracy actors in supporting Democrats in Myanmar was the Rohingya issue. The Rohingya issue posed two problems for Western countries. First, sanction measures in response to the coup were unlikely to have substantial impact because of existing sanctions on the same targets. Given the worsening of the persecution of Rohingya after 2017, Western countries imposed targeted sanctions on the military leadership of Myanmar and pulled their investments. Targeted sanctions and not comprehensive sanctions was chosen as the method in order to limit the impact on the general public. The US further tightened targeted sanctions against military personnel in 2019. Having these existing sanctions, it was not easy to find new targets to make the military feel an added pain of sanctions. The United States, the UK, Canada, the EU, and New Zealand have gradually expanded sanctions against the military leadership and military-related companies after the February coup. However, they were well aware that the impact of their targeted sanctions was limited. They cannot make impacts to the military without cooperation of countries with strong economic ties to Myanmar, such as Singapore, China, and Japan. The second point that troubled the West over the Rohingya issue was how to support Democrats while not weakening their commitment to tackling the Rohingya issue. This manifested as the West's hesitation in expressing support for Aung San Suu Kyi as the symbol of the civil disobedience movement. I mean, as the symbol for the civil disobedience movement. Such a hesitation arose because the Myanmar government prior to the coup headed by Aung San Suu Kyi had denied the intention of the military to persecute the Rohingya. Whereas Western countries condemn the February coup and grant support for the government based on the results of the November 2020 elections, they do not intend to weaken their commitment to address the Rohingya crisis either. This led the West to be cautious in its language and actions, taking the position of supporting CDM as a movement and the CRPH as a parliament based on the election results, rather than showing support for the incarcerated Aung San Suu Kyi personally, as was done until 2010. The NUG understood this point precisely. The appointment of Excellency Zima Aung, who is joining us today, whose video was shown just today, as foreign minister, was a symbolic move to show NUG's stance on the Rohingya issue. Foreign Minister Zima Aung had been using the term Rohingya since her days as a democracy activist. This contrasts with the NLD government before the coup, which did not use the term Rohingya, but referred to them as Rakhine people. On the 3rd of last month, the NUG released a position paper on Rohingya, stating that it will initiate processes to grant International Criminal Court jurisdiction over crimes committed within Myanmar against the Rohingya and other communities. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken's tweet welcoming the announcement indicates that NUG's statement functioned as a positive signal for Western countries. Such a gesture from NUG was much needed to orchestrate support for NUG from Western governments and democracy actors. NUG's appointment of ministers from ethnic minority political parties also facilitated understanding and support from the West. The inclusion of ethnic minority political parties in NUG was, of course, a necessary move to form a strong cooperative relationship among different ethnic groups within Myanmar in resisting the military. But there was even a greater message. This move showed the international community that NUG is willing to form a national identity based on ethnic harmony beyond Burman nationalism, as opposed to the previous national system. Thus, the NUG is not a simple anti-military and pro-democracy government. The NUG is taking a progressive movement to form a new, more integrated Myanmar. While the military was unilaterally suppressing the Democrats, the inhumanity of the military's actions was evident even in the eyes of those who don't know much about the Myanmar crisis. Hence, regardless of the difficulties surrounding the Rohingya issue, the international community condemned the inhumane actions of the military without hesitation and expressed support for the pro-democracy side. However, after Myanmar went into a civil war-like situation, especially with the formation of the People's Defense Force, or PDF, the hurdle to issuing a simple message of support for Democrats was raised. The Western governments are well aware that PDF was created for the purpose of defense. However, since they cannot overtly support the use of violence itself, they have been forced to take the difficult step of supporting the Democrats while avoiding wars and actions that affirm their use of violence. In light of these difficult decisions, statements of support for Democrats in Myanmar from governments around the world might seem somewhat weakened in the months ahead. On the other hand, continuous morale support from the international society is a key for the people in Myanmar to continue their protest against the military. The repression of Democrats in Myanmar is still going on. Last week, the military released 2,300 out of more than 6,500 people it had detained since the February coup. And some media reported that this was a sign that the military was confident in governance. However, the targets of investigation and arrest are likely to expand once the detention of frontline democracy activists is over. With each passing day since the coup, the bar for leaving the country to seek a temporary refuge has risen as well, and this trend is expected to intensify. We must not weaken the pro-democracy narrative, even as governments are forced to navigate the difficult waters and reduce the issuance of statements of support for the pro-democracy side in Myanmar. And this will require civil society actors in each country to stand in solidarity and continue to support Myanmar's democrats in terms of both discourse and practical assistance. The condemnation of the military and support for the democrats has been widely expressed by civil society actors in all over Asia and not only in the West. In Japan as well, university students, activists, researchers, journalists, parliamentarians, and a wide range of general public have been actively supporting the democrats in Myanmar. Many of you would be aware that Professor Nemoto's crowdfunding campaign has raised a historic amount of money. University students in the Kansai region are also involved in weekly fundraising activities for the 1-to-1 CDM campaign. The people of Myanmar are in danger of poverty, not only due to the oppression of the military, but also because of the pandemic in order to save the lives of the people of Myanmar. Continuous advocacy and practical support from the external actors is necessary. And last but not least, academics should cooperate with governments around the world if there is something we can do for the people of Myanmar that governmental actors cannot do. Let me stop here. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Meiko-san. Excellent, very detailed analysis and quite a good message for us, academia. Second panelist is Professor Nemoto, K. Nemoto. Is now, of course, no need to introduce him. He's a most knowledgeable, outstanding expert on the Myanmar. So please, it's your turn, 10 minutes, please, Nemoto-sensei.
Thank you very much, Professor Sato, for your kind introduction. Hello, everybody. I'm Kei Nemoto. I'm specialized in the modern history of Myanmar since nearly 40 years ago. Today, I would like to talk about three matters. The first is about the Japanese government's understanding of the history of the relationship between Japan and Myanmar. This is important in order to deepen our understanding of the background of the Japanese government's unchanged friendly posture towards the Myanmar Armed Forces, TAMARU. Not all, but many of the influential Japanese officials, business persons, and policymakers who have got involved in Japan-Myanmar relations set great value on the discourse of so-called Japan's special relationship with Myanmar since World War II, without looking into the historical facts related to the war carefully. Therefore, we should think about it dispassionately. Post-war relations between Japan and Myanmar officially started from April of 1955, when a peace treaty was signed and an agreement on war reparations went into effect. Following the resumption of official diplomatic relations, the Japanese government paid $200 million over the decade since 1955 in goods and services in accordance with the agreement on war reparations. A new agreement between the two countries in 1963 provided for another $140 million, which was in reality a continuation of the war reparations. These projects were transformed into Japanese ODA in 1970s. Japan's ODA to Myanmar, which actually replaced war reparations, began from 1968 in the form of yen loans. The grant aid was also started from 1975. the amount of ODA towards Myanmar increased rapidly from the latter half of 1970s, since Myanmar altered its position to actively receive ODA in order to overcome its seriously stagnant domestic economy under the regime of so-called Burmese Way to Socialism. Myanmar received Japanese ODA funds for large-scale projects, mainly for the development of social infrastructure. Throughout the late 1970s and 80s, Japan was the top donor towards Myanmar. Why did Japan continue to give extraordinary amounts of aid to Myanmar? The answer for that lies in non-rational reasons, such as Japan's special consideration for Myanmar and vice versa, rather than rational reasons, such as the important economic or political relationship between the two countries. In the discourse among influential Japanese in diplomatic, political, and economic matters, they constantly referred to a special relationship between Japan and Myanmar, or a historically friendly relationship between the two countries. The thinking behind this discourse was that while Japan had brought a great deal of inconvenience to Myanmar during World War II, it also made significant contributions to the country. Young nationalists such as Aung San and Ne Win were educated and trained by Japanese army officers, leading to the birth of the Burma Independence Army, BIA. This army, BIA, subsequently developed into the Burma National Army, which was the origin of the nowadays Myanmar Armed Forces, TAMADO. During the Japanese occupation period, Japan also accepted many Burmese students, providing them with scholarships. Most of those students, military and civilians, rose to positions of national leadership in post-independence Myanmar. Therefore, Japan's post-war officials and policymakers owed the great feeling that these Japan-made young Myanmar elites should be supported. However, this understanding fails to consider other important elements that cannot be ignored when we recalling the history of independence in Myanmar. Those are the anti-Japanese struggle in 1945 and the process of crucial negotiations for independence with British authorities between 1945 and 47, both under the leadership of Aung San. Understanding the history of Japan-Myanmar relations, just as a special and friendly relationship between the two countries, shares a one-sided interpretation. In 1988, Myanmar witnessed the large mass movement demanding democratic change and economic reform. However, in September, the armed forces regained control over the movement and established a genuine military administration. The Japanese government was among the first nations to recognize the military junta in February 1989. Although Japanese ODA stopped temporarily during the time of the People's Uprising, it was later resumed. But a freeze was put on new yen loans. From the beginning, the Japanese government's posture towards the military administration was one of soft persuasion. It didn't resort to economic sanctions. Japanese government behaved as a good friend of Myanmar, persuading the military junta to open up Myanmar's economy, as well as to move towards democracy and stop human rights violations. Although the Japanese government didn't ignore the importance of Aung San Suu Kyi and her party, National League for Democracy, it didn't express strong support towards them either. However, in spite of these friendly posture towards the military junta, the positive change didn't occur among the junta for nearly 23 years. We can't conclude that the Japanese friendly treatment of the junta was successful. In 2011, 10 years ago, the Myanmar Armed Forces ended their direct rule and adopted a quasi-democratic style of regime, which was based on military-made 2008 constitution, the present constitution. Though the civilian control was limitedly admitted, the armed forces continued to hold their full power among national defense, police, and border security. They were also allotted 25% of the seats at each upper and lower house. A so-called legal coup clause was also included in the constitution, which was misused at the February coup this year. The change towards a quasi-democratic style government brought the Japanese government to restart a full economic and political support for Myanmar. It wrote off the whole 500 billion yen debt which Myanmar had owed through Japanese yen loans since the 1970s. In 2019 budget year, the Japanese ODA to Myanmar amounted more than 119 billion yen. Though the generations who experienced World War II in Japan and Myanmar have mostly disappeared, the historical discourse of special relationship between Japan and Myanmar still remains in Japan. This is still one of the reasons for the Japanese government to justify their large-scale support to Myanmar. However, we should notice carefully that since the 1990s, the armed forces has changed their characteristics, not only as the army refusing civilian control, but also as the army doing their business in the full scale for their own profits. The Ministry of Defense owns two big holdings, Myanmar Economic Holdings Limited and Myanmar Economic Corporation, which consists of more than 130 companies. Their profits as dividend to stockholder exceed national defense budget every year. Moreover, the amount of dividend is tax-free and its information is not open to the public. In such situation, we should think about the possibility that the actual beneficiary of the ODA will be the armed forces, since some of the Myanmar companies related to Japanese ODA projects have relations to the Ministry of Defense. Whether the discourse of special relationship between Japan and Myanmar is right or not, the Japanese government should halt the whole ODA projects and rethink about the better support for the people in Myanmar through opening dialogues with the National Unity Government, NUG, which the majority of the Myanmar people are supporting. The second matter which I would like to mention is about the importance of NUG to get an accreditation at the new session of the United Nations 76th General Assembly, which begins on 14th September. As we know, the present Myanmar representative to the UN, U Chomotun, takes up a position of NUG. The procedures of accreditation starts from the forming of a credential committee, which the chairperson of the General Assembly nominates the members. It consists of 9 members, traditionally including the US, Russia, and China. Usually, the committee's work is a sort of a ritual, but this time it will be indeed a D-Day for NUG. If the credential committee is not able to decide by themselves, the case will be voted at the General Assembly to decide, and the final decision seems to be out by December this year. There will be no veto, only one country, one vote system. NUG may be elected as the official permanent representative, or could be otherwise, or it could be delayed until the next 77th UN General Assembly. During the last voting on 18th June this year, when the General Assembly voted for an arms embargo against Myanmar, there were 119 yes votes, one no, which was Belarus, 37 non-committal and 36 abstentions. It seems not easy to expect the same numbers this time. I therefore would like to ask Her Excellency Do Zima Aung, the Minister of Foreign Affairs, about her government's preparation for this D-Day. In my focus, the Japanese government, which voted yes on 18th June, may turn into abstention this time, though we should work upon them to vote for U Chomotun. The third matter of my talk is about the Myanmar people living in Japan. More than 36,000 Myanmar passport holders are now staying here in Japan, and many of them are being aware of the dangerous situation of their motherland. The most important question is about their stay permit. The Japanese government up to now has permitted 6-month extension to 3,000 Myanmar passport holders approximately, but there are still more who are waiting for. Especially, some passport holders are afraid of being canceled their passports by the Myanmar embassy because of participating in the civil disobedience movement in Japan. We have to think about it carefully and work upon the Japanese government in order to ensure their safety by giving special permit to them unconditionally. As for the Myanmar university students in Japan, even if a university wants to treat them fairly, they can do nothing if those students are faced with the cancellation of their passports by their embassy and the Japanese government gives no support for them. Well, Myanmar is in crisis. As the member of Global Citizens, it is our human duty to show solidarity towards the people of Myanmar. At the same time, we can learn many things from them: courage, persistence, women's power, and their sense of humor, which they own since the British colonial days. They are not the people who are just waiting for our support. They are the people who are actually fighting for themselves in various ways against the inhuman military regime. Thank you for listening.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Nemoto. It's a really great, very extensive, very detailed discussion based on your long commitment of the area studies, the history, and also current analysis. It's a quite a sharp analysis we learned. Thank you very much. So let's continue to the third speaker, panelist. I think she from the Indonesia, please, Evan. Mr. Evan Laksmana, please, it's your floor. Yes. Please start by your introduction yourself for the, I think from Jakarta, Indonesia. Thank you very much for your very difficult time in Indonesia too, also yourself. Thank you, please.
Thank you, Professor. And let me say thank you again to the organizer for having me today. I do apologize if I'm a little bit incoherent as I'm slowly recovering from COVID last week. But right now I'm okay, and I'd like to talk about how Indonesia has sort of responded to the challenges in Myanmar and tied that discussion with the problem surrounding ASEAN's approach to the crisis in Myanmar. If you allow me, I'd like 1 minute to share the screen so that I'll have some slides. I'll speak at them very quickly, and hopefully we'll get to talk more towards the end. So very quickly, at the beginning, after the coup, Indonesia had thought about a few different sets of options in terms of how to approach the problem. At first, I think for the first week or so, there were discussions within the foreign ministry and beyond regarding what steps Indonesia should take, because Indonesia, while we very much want to help the people of Myanmar, we also realize that we don't have a lot of leverage to play with. We don't have strong economic investments, and we don't even have our, to speak candidly, we don't necessarily have the best diplomatic assets there as well. So we don't have a lot of leverage. So we contemplated a few different options, whether it's unilateral steps and condemnation, or is it diplomatic steps and try to push through some sort of negotiated outcome. And we settled on the ASEAN option rather than the non-ASEAN option. Naturally, going through ASEAN is Indonesia's first instinctive response, but that also means that Indonesia's response and the region's response, if it's tied to ASEAN, then it comes with the constraints that comes with ASEAN, whether it's the role of the ASEAN chair, whether it's the limitations of the ASEAN charter, as well as the weak role of the Secretary General. But it also means that ASEAN also has the opportunity, because it also remains one of the few diplomatic fora where Myanmar feels welcome. And I think this is a dilemma for Indonesia, and I think it remains a dilemma for the rest of Southeast Asia as well. As time goes, before the ASEAN leaders meeting 2 months ago, and I think it's still valid probably until today, a lot of countries in the region, including Indonesia, still believe that there's only two possible outcomes right now. Do we allow for a war of attrition to continue, and we choose sides? And naturally, most of us, not all of us, most of us would choose to support the civilian side, but we just wait out until see how things develop on the ground. But of course, that's not great for the people of Myanmar. A prolonged war of attrition hurts the people rather than the ruling government. So we try to push through a negotiated process. But of course, the ASEAN option is the one that we have on the table. I'll talk about that a little bit more later on, but there are no more non-ASEAN options on the table. There is nothing that comes out of the UN. and there's nothing that comes out of the big powers. And in fact, since the ASEAN leaders meeting, I think regional countries, Japan, China, India, even Russia and others have said that they supported ASEAN efforts. Of course, when they say they support ASEAN's effort, means they say that rhetorically, because they bypass their responsibility to ASEAN and let ASEAN do the dirty work, because it saves them from them doing the hard work of engaging Myanmar themselves. And I think this is a very difficult question for ASEAN, because I think ASEAN right now, we have to be clear that ASEAN is not just a group of 10, but there's also a particular role of the ASEAN chair that's, I think in this particular instance, over the past 2 months has been particularly disruptive, if not destructive, to the overall efforts to engage Myanmar. When we contemplated a series of ASEAN and non-ASEAN options, we at CSIS convened an internal working group, but also a track to regional working group across Southeast Asia. We invited about two or three from each country representing different research institutions and think tanks. But we also believe these individuals also have direct access to their respective governments. So we wanted to make sure that the track to ideas generation process is not simply an academic exercise, but we can also we talked about and we weigh different diplomatic options from their effectiveness to legitimacy. And I think we still settled on ASEAN. But I think right now, after the ASEAN leaders meeting, I think we're leaning towards finding non-ASEAN options. And we should be ready in case the ASEAN option, I think, pretty much breakdowns. This is the 5-point consensus agreed upon. Right now, we don't have any of this. And worse, the ASEAN chair has surrendered the initiatives to the junta by giving the list of the special envoy for the junta to choose. So the chair effectively passes its responsibility to the junta in Myanmar. So I think this is a very concerning situation, but I think a breaking point or an impasse should happen soon in August, which is the ASEAN ministerial meeting of foreign affairs, where I think we have to decide, do we still stick with this 5-point consensus, or do we move our separate ways and find other options? This is the current option as it stands today. Indonesia and others, I think, are contemplating potential unilateral actions. And by unilateral, I mean things that we decide ourselves, regardless of what other countries decide. Do we want to recognize NUG? Do we want to limit our interaction with the SAC, for example, reducing ambassador level to DCM? These are not popular ideas, obviously, but it is being discussed, I think, privately. There are initial ideas about a bilateral option where, for example, Japan and Indonesia could lead a new concerted effort, but we're not sure how. Multilateral, I think, remains still stuck between ASEAN and UNSC. It's not moving anywhere. Minilateral options, kind of a regional coalition, for example, between Malaysia, Indonesia, Singapore, and the Philippines, or those four countries plus the UN, or maybe Japan and India, I think have been discussed, but again, not many traction. So what's left right now is pretty much the track two level, where civil society groups, I think, are still focused on providing assistance and solidarity. And I think the think tank network in Southeast Asia remains ongoing, although right now, obviously, there's no appetite, I think, among the regional governments because of COVID and because of other concerns. So at this point, the track one level, I think, is stuck. It's pretty much landing everything at the feet of ASEAN. Well, ASEAN is not really moving very far. So I think right now it's time to increase the role for non-state actors at the track two level. But of course, we have to prepare for the long game, that this will not be resolved within any 6 months or a year. It could be longer. Network building, I think, is missing. A network between parliamentarians, civil society, and think tanks are sparse. It's there, but very thin. So it's time to increase network building among different supporters and friends of Myanmar and stakeholders across the region, particularly within Myanmar. Others have mentioned about solidarity and support. So I think from the perspective of Indonesia And ASEAN right now, we are still waiting, but I do think that we have to put a clock on our efforts in terms of relying on ASEAN. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Evans. Unfortunately, the first pages to the three pages we couldn't see, but I guess your PowerPoint can be available in some way to this review, and also all this session be recorded. So after editing, we just publicize. So maybe you can check it. And anyway, thank you very much for your updating of the ASEAN positions. We are very much expecting ASEAN leadership, but I think we can not see so well. Your clarification is good for understanding us for the ASEAN's standpoint. And the second track, we are very curious. I hope we Japanese civil societies also could join you as a partner for this kind of a very difficult time as a solidarity, as you suggested. Thank you very much. So finally, but not the last, the least, and Mr. Romain Caud, my pronunciation, the French, I'm not a good French. Anyway, please, it's your turn, your specific point on the business and human rights, especially the Japanese corporate representative also participating. It's very much interested in your topic. Thank you.
Thank you, Sato-sensei. And thank you very much for the opportunity to contribute today. So I have two hats currently. One is as a business advisor. I work with investors and corporations both in Japan and in Southeast Asia around risk and reputation issues. But today, I'm wearing my hat of associate fellow at the Institute of Southeast Asian Studies in Singapore, Youth of Ishak Institute. And so I will be speaking as a researcher rather than as a consultant. And really what I'm going to talk about in relation to business and human rights, I have touched upon in an article I published in Fulcrum, which is the blog of the ICS Yusof Ishak Institute. And I published this article in April 2021, so earlier this year. And really, I think my findings and from then still hold. And really, in a nutshell, what I want to share with the audience today, especially business persons, is that the coup is very bad for business. And I think now this has become obvious given the events in recent months. But I was quite surprised because right after the coup, in the first weeks after the State Administrative Council was established and the military took control of the Myanmar state, you could hear in the business community, in part of the business community, some people saying that, well, it would not be too bad. We would be dealing with an enlightened dictatorship. You look at what's happening in Thailand. And the NLD was not doing so well when it came to managing the economy. And really, I think those are misconceptions. Those are really deep misunderstanding. And I think it has become clearer given of the actions in of the military regime in recent months that this is not going to be a Tencent 2.0 type of situation. And here I refer to President Tencent, former military general, who really was seen as the military reformist from 2011 to 2015. And so I will organize my presentation today around three remarks. And the first one is that the coup has turned back the clock on a decade of economic reforms. But because these economic reforms were underpinned by political liberalization. And so really what you, I mean, I lived in Myanmar before 2011, 2012, and the country was one of the poorest in Asia, it still is. But I think really the political economy was very different from what it was until the coup. And it was many agrarian economy, also exploitation of natural resources, limited trade and investment with the outside world, and also highly corrupt and untransparent. And what we saw starting from 2010 onwards was a normalization of the economy, thanks to the flawed yet somewhat effective political reform process that was started with the 2010 elections and reinforced with the 2015 elections and again the November 2020 elections. And this normalization of the economy allowed for the development of a private sector, independent private sector, alongside military business interests, and also the integration of Myanmar with global trade and investment networks. And again, this progress was enabled by political reforms. And so now that the political reforms have stopped, we also see this, this process of economic liberalization unraveling. And I'll give two examples there. First, look at what international financial institutions are doing. I'm referring here specifically to the World Bank and the ADB. There are others, and they have suspended their development programs, loans, grants, technical capacity building, all of that. And what we are seeing instead of development is a return to humanitarian aid, you know, because of the situation on the ground. And so really it's not anymore about helping the Myanmar economy to grow, to become more inclusive and transparent and accountable. It's really trying to put a band-aid on a humanitarian wound that is growing every day. My second example is around sanctions. And while in 2016, after the 2015 elections that brought the NLD government to power, you saw the Obama administration lift its emergency order and end Myanmar-specific sanctions against against Myanmar. Now you saw just after the coup, the Biden administration adopt a new executive order specific to Myanmar. And since the number and range of sanctions has been increasing and expanding, and there is likely more to come. So again, I think here my first point is that for return to business and economic normal, there is a need for return to political stability, democratization, and the rule of law. And I think that's really important for Japanese companies and other in the business sector to keep that in mind, that true normalization is just not possible under the current military regime. My second point is that there is a new political economy that is emerging in the current Myanmar, controlled by a military regime, and that political economy is reminiscent of what we saw pre-2010. And that does not bode well for responsible business actors. And what you see is a military regime using both sticks and carrots to try to bring the business community on its side. And here I'm talking about both domestic and foreign businesses. When it comes to sticks, you saw very powerful tycoons, Myanmar tycoons, being interrogated and somewhat threatened. Also recently, there was a report by Reuters sharing how foreign executives in the telecom sector had been prohibited from leaving the country unless their companies adopted certain measures. And so in parallel to these sticks, you also see new carrots appearing. And so it will be interesting to see which Myanmar companies, but also foreign companies, become the new cronies in this new order. For example, at the moment, there is an ongoing solar power tender, and we see a number of Myanmar companies, but also Chinese companies considering taking part. And so really, in this new order, we should keep in mind that there is still some business going on and that nature avoids vacuum. And so this week, I think a big news was the departure from the market of Norwegian telecoms company Telenor. And this is quite a blow also for an important part of the economy. So my last point, and I'll go fast, I see I'm running out of time, sorry for that. But my last point will be how the economic gains of the last decade can be protected as much as possible, and how to promote business and human rights principles and activities in the current Myanmar, despite the deep challenges that everyone faces. And so first, I would like to emphasize that the Myanmar of today, of July 2021, is not the Myanmar of 2011. And that as a result, I think whatever measures, sanctions, engagement, pressure, et cetera, are adopted by foreign and domestic actors need to be calibrated to this new context. And there, for example, when we look at the telecom sector, the issue is not one of connectivity. Back in 2011, you had one service provider which was state-owned, and very few Myanmar people were able to afford access to a phone or to the internet, which was reserved for a very small privileged elite. This is not the case anymore. So I think the issue now is how to try to fight back against surveillance, data localization, and other type of such measures that the military regime wants to push on to telecoms service providers. My second point here is that responsible business actors are part of the solution. Again, I think we saw since 2011, quite a number of good companies enter the market. And I think that departure is a blow to the Myanmar people and the pro-democracy movement rather than any success, like we see with Telenor leaving this week. But also, for example, I would like to mention briefly about the garment sector. And we saw, you know, which employs hundreds of thousands of low-skilled poor people, and a departure of such brands providing jobs to low-skilled poor Myanmar people, I think does not benefit the country or even the pro-democratic movement. My third point here will be about businesses, including Japanese businesses, how it is essential that moving forward, if they operate in Myanmar, that they be transparent and accountable, and that they engage with stakeholders to explain about the dilemma that they fail in this current challenging operating environment and how they try to address these issues and dilemmas. And so I will conclude there on this point, that dialogue you know, between businesses and other actors is essential, by mentioning the Myanmar Center for Responsible Business, which is one of the gains of the last decade, I'd say, which was established in Myanmar after 2011, and that brings together various business actors and other stakeholders to try to collectively seek solutions to try to promote rule of law, accountability, and other important values that I think businesses should align behind, values that are in line with the UN general principles on business and human rights. So thank you again for the opportunity to contribute today, and I look forward to taking part in the Q&A.
Well, thank you very much, Romain. It's a very practical analysis and good advice, I think, for especially the Japanese private sector, who actually is stuck and wondering what to do anyway. So all the panelists, thank you very much for a nice presentation in time. Her Excellency Zima Aung, we are waiting for her, but probably it's not possible to join today because of the security reasons, as I suggested. So now I think this question answer for panelists to be also jointly with the questions to the High Excellency Zima Aung without her, you know, but probably some of the panelists can answer, maybe some sort of a guessing and use these positions from your, you know, kind of a research experiences so on. I know it's a very difficult, but let me introduce our colleague, actually the Professor Akihara Hanto, who is now the director of the our Research Center for Peace. She is actually the moderator of the question and answer first, but we jointly do that with her. Could you just summarize any questions already have the previous registration and also some sort of a question answer, and maybe just summarize and then maybe just we distribute some specifically concerned expert panelist answer, or anyway, we discuss as a kind of a point to discussion. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for kind introduction. My name is Akihara Hunt, and I'm moderating this Q&A. Now, I think there are a few, quite a lot of pre-registered questions, but I'm trying to group those questions together so that you can pick the questions that you can answer. And some of the questions are specific to some of the panelists. So I think one big area of questions were about the representation. So what is your assessment of the representation of people by NUG and how do you foresee the prospect that they can move forward with this process? That's one area about the representation and democratization. And I think in that relation, there is a question that was registered today about the prospect for negotiation. So is there much prospect for getting everybody at the table to discuss and go hold them to stop violence and move forward? I think while you are taking notes, I will try to speak slowly. The next about the human security. So human security, one part of this human security questions that was also registered today is how do we balance freedom from want and freedom from fear? So freedom from fear seems to be centered around protection of people, the safety of people. Protection from the freedom from want seems to be about economic activities and economic sanctions, the impact on business. So how do you suggest to balance human security with regard to freedom from want and freedom from fear? Maybe I can take just one more before your brain becomes full. So that is about the rest of the population. So what do you see the role of Japan? And there are questions with regard to government's role, and there's a question about people's role. So what do you think Japan should do, the government and people? And what do you think Japan's approach is doing? Like, is it making progress? Japan's approach is very much focused on dialogue. So how do you evaluate that? And maybe that is Evan and Romain. Maybe it's more about the role of ASEAN. And probably there's another question about Indonesia's role. So maybe if you could enlighten us with that roles of external actors. Maybe I will stop here first.
Yeah. So of course, if you want to volunteer to answer, but otherwise maybe we should just ask Tan and Tan from the, Michael and Kay or anyone who want to. Maybe the question for the representation would be addressed to the Nemoto sensei, probably the most knowledgeable, I think.
Allow me to speak in Japanese. The person who can't understand Japanese, please listen to the simultaneous interpretation.
So,
まあ、NUG の代表性ですね、ミャンマーの国民をどこまで代表しているか、これは間違いなく、 国民の7割8割は NUG を多かれ少なかれ支持していると思います。特に Z 世代、ジェネレーション Z と呼ばれる20代のミャンマーの人々の NUG への期待支持は非常に強い。これは限定的な世論調査、ヤンゴン限定の世論調査でも現れているんですね。で、上の世代もですね、Z 世代よりも上の世代も NUG への期待はかなり強いと思います。でこの Z 世代っていうのはミャンマーの総人口の 25% を占めていて、将来のミャンマー、未来のミャンマーを担う人々なんですね。でこの人たちが基本的に、ミャンマーをこう作り直したい、こうなってほしいというものを NUG が受け入れて、フェデラルデモクラシー、フェデラル民主主義という、まあ、そういう言葉で新しいミャンマーの、まあ、構想というものを示しているわけです。で私の短い話、まあ、時間オーバーしたとはいえ短い話の中で触れたんですけども、 NUG は今度9月の14日に、まさにD デイとでも呼べるような重要な日を迎えます。国連の、このジェネラルアセンブリー総会でですね、ミャンマーの代表性クレデンシャルについて決定がなされる、まあ、12月まで伸びると思うんですけども、最終的には投票決着で、ここで勝てるかどうかなんですね。ここにで勝てますと国際的な潮流が変わる、潮目が変わって NUG が国際社会において有利になる可能性が高いんですね。しかしここで負けますとね、NUG は非常に難しい立場に追い込まれる。現在やはりオンライン政権、まあ、今日外務大臣が参加できないというのは非常に気の毒な状況ですね、まあ、オンライン政権のある種の限界が今日示されてしまっていると思うんですけども、このオンライン政権の NUG をより、実際の政権として強めていくことができるかどうかは9月14日以降の国連総会でのクレデンシャル信任状の審査と投票にかかっていると思っています。したがってそこに向けて NUG が何ができるか、またもちろん市民社会がどういう応援ができるか、それが問われていると思います。
Thank you very much, Professor Nemoto. How about Michael, from international point of view, in the politics, how you think the representation, the NUG?
I think that's really Nemoto-sensei's area of research. And so let me not take that question, but instead let me take another question related to international relations. Mm-hmm. Of course, it's also related to the domestic politics. It's mainly about domestic politics. But one of the questions that Kihara Hanto-sensei rose for us was how the related actors can bring to that and will come to the negotiation table, and how we can make progress on in terms of the peace process. I would raise two factors. Of course, there are multiple factors that are important, it's very difficult indeed to make progress on in the peace process. But one is that we have to make sure that we continue conveying the pro-democracy voice, even under this current situation. We have to show that participants of CDM have to show that they still support the democratic process in the country. And they are supporting the side of the government that facilitates the democratic process. And secondly, however, currently the military is so difficult to sort of weaken and bring to the table, because there is so much propaganda and disinformation going on within the military itself, from the military leadership, top leadership, to sort of brainwash the military members. And so we have to think how to sort of weaken the integration of the military itself. It's a job for the CDM participants, how they can reach out to the members of the military, how they can influence them and well, how they can create counter narratives for that purpose.
Okay, thank you very much. Any response, Nemoto-sensei, or anyone, Ivan from the ASEAN point of view, or Romain from business side, any sort of a representation of the NUG, and also the how to negotiate, who, you know, just be participate for the this process of negotiation and this on the anyone?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Thank you. I guess I'll just tack on the questions on negotiation and the role of ASEAN in Indonesia.
Mm-hmm.
I think the two key questions for negotiation right now is under whose terms and who's going to mediate. Mm-hmm. I think without answering those two questions, I think it'll be difficult to expect that both sides on their own terms are willing to negotiate. That's, I think we have way past that point. So the issue is which third party is going to mediate if we assume that the problem won't be solved by things on the ground. Assuming that there is some sort of diplomatic breakthrough, it would have to be a third party mediation. But who that person is, I think remains debated. I think some people would like it to be the UN Special Envoy. Some people would like it to be ASEAN Special Envoy. Some people would like it both. And I don't think we have a good answer on that. And this goes back, I think, to the point about ASEAN's role. Right now, Indonesia's position remains that we already made the call to return to democracy. Our Indonesian president made that call explicitly a few months ago that we would like things to return to democracy. So the current situation is obviously not ideal and not what we would like, but we don't have enough leverage outside of ASEAN to do things on our own. So it would have to be through ASEAN. Now, the problem with ASEAN right now is a couple things. One, the current chair right now is basically running out the clock. They have like about maybe 5 months now before they hand it over to Cambodia. Now, a lot of people are very skeptical about Cambodia, but Cambodia is actually behind closed doors, actually quite constructive in their efforts to persuade the junta, but also in showing its support. Yes, in public, they seem to be ambivalent, but I think on issues like this, they have a deep personal sense of trying to help. So I think it's a bit of an encouraging sign. But of course, they expect that when they get hand over the problem, things would have move along. The second problem, I think, is the special envoy role. Now, the special envoy is very tricky because, to be honest, before the ASEAN leaders meeting, the discussions at the track two and track one level never really got into detail of how to select the special envoy, who that special envoy is going to be. The focus before the ASEAN leaders meeting was on the outcomes that we would like to achieve, and which is why the 5-point consensus has 3 points that's about the outcome: the cessation of violence, the delivery of aid, and inclusive political dialogue. And then the other two, the special envoy and visit, was supposed to be the methods to deliver that outcome. Now, the special envoy is the special envoy of the chair, which means the chair has complete autonomy to select. What's holding them back? It's not very clear. One thing that's very troublesome right now for the chair is that the ASEAN chair has changed the way ASEAN usually communicates. Usually there is transparency among all members, but right now the chair talks to individual ASEAN members bilaterally without communicating with the rest. So there is a lack of transparency about how the engagement with Myanmar has been progressing. Right now, on paper, we have 2 potential special envoys. Malaysia put forward its own candidate out of the blue at the ASEAN China meeting in Chongqing before that. So it's 3, but right now I think the list in Myanmar, I think, is 2 names, one from Indonesia, one from Thailand. And my understanding is that the junta prefers the one from Thailand. Of course, that creates more consequences down the line because of the close military to military relationship between the 2 armed forces. Lastly, I think the big problem aside from special envoy is how to implement the five-point consensus. This is tricky because some members like Indonesia believe that the five-point consensus has to be delivered as a single unified package, that there has to be aid, there has to be inclusive dialogue, and there has to be cessation of violence. This has to be a package deal. You cannot have one over the other. My worry is that the second interpretation, which the junta prefers, is to have the five-point consensus delivered separately. They just want the aid, but they don't want the peace dialogue. They want the aid in particular to be delivered to the AHA Center. This is very problematic because AHA Center is governed by a governing board that consists of the representatives of each ASEAN member governments, including the Myanmar government, the Ministry of Social Welfare, I think, if I'm not wrong. So that means that the junta will have control over how aid is going to be administered if it's done solely through AHA Center without the special envoy being able to deliver the dialogue process and the cessation of violence. So this is, I think, a key debate between ASEAN members. Do we deliver the five-point consensus as a package deal? If we do, this is a long-term commitment because right now we don't know how this ends. We don't know what is the conditions under which ASEAN say, okay, we're done helping. Is it until there is a new government in place? Is it only until there's a dialogue? Is it only when there's no more violence? We don't know. This is the problem with the absence of a framework to implement the five-point consensus. So I think right now, these are things that are still being discussed. Hopefully, this can be decided at the ASEAN ministerial meeting next month in August, but I'm not very optimistic. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Evan. But some audience also asked special Indonesian experiences. In fact, Indonesia is one of the successful democratization or transition. You know, even you have some kind of new general election. So I mean the sort of history of the military of the especially Timor Estes conflicts and so on. Any sort of lessons learned from some Indonesian point of view, and maybe this would be, I don't know, this is good for current Myanmar, but any?
Sure. Actually, we had built communications with a few research groups and civil society in Myanmar, particularly on lesson sharing, what Indonesia can share from experience. And I think there's three areas. One, with regards to decentralization and regional autonomy. Mm-hmm. How do we manage the diversity of local governments, ethnic groups, and so forth, and what kind of political system works best for a decentralized regime. A second group of lessons, I think, has to do with post-conflict situation. Mm-hmm. I know for a fact that Indonesia brought a few groups from Myanmar to Aceh to see how things were implemented. But this was before COVID, of course. How things were implemented after conflict, what kind of political arrangements at the local level could work between ethnic groups at the local levels and the central government. So that's second. The third one is a lot more difficult, but I think is probably essential, which is the role of the military. Mm. Now, the problem with the comparison with Indonesia is that Indonesia's transition, there was an elite pact to step out of the formal political realm, but being protected in terms of its a bureaucratic autonomy, which means the Indonesian military gets to decide how it wants to reform itself. Mm-hmm. Now, at the time, it made sense. But right now, as we look back 20 years after, I think there are a couple things that if somewhere down the line, Myanmar has a similar pact to exit, to push the military out of politics, here's a couple of things that I wish the military in our side did not do. One, I think, is the fact that we focus too much on compensating the exit by giving them more money. Mm-hmm. So in Indonesia, when we take the military out of politics, we compensate it by increasing defense budget, by providing military hardware, and so forth and so on. Mm-hmm. But we never actually pushed for institutional reform. How is the personnel managed? What kind of welfare do they have? New doctrine, new training, new education. These are the software part, which I think has been untouched in Indonesia, and why in Indonesia itself, I think the role of the military remains expansive, albeit not formal. So I think if somewhere down the line, Myanmar decides to transition away from military a role in politics, the focus should not be just on compensating with money and hardware, but a fundamental institutional reform, top down from organization to education and training, I think should be part of that.
I see. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So Romain, I think some points, especially for human security, is consisted of the freedom from fear and the freedom for wants. Wants and fear, it's come together, but sometimes it's the dilemma. I think case in Myanmar is a dilemma, in fact, you know, for the, because the people are suffer even now, is the medical or food or sort of a lot of want, I think.
Yeah.
We have to, you know, bring it. But also, someone says it's supposed to some sanctions, maybe it's a targeted sanction or human rights violation, something like that. So, or economic sanctions. So, well, but this affects, of course, the civilians. So, how to do that? How the private sector will contribute, retreat or just stand or just, yeah, what the responsive business in your side for this very difficult question, please.
Yeah, thank you, Sato Sensei. And those are very difficult sanctions, difficult questions and indeed dilemmas. And I think when you look at how the US and the European Union and all the Western actors have approached so far the discussion on sanctions, they have been quite cautious and trying to keep them as targeted as possible to key members of the ruling military elite, but with the downside that the impact is in a way limited, but at the same time, collateral damage is avoided. And I think really the main concern at the moment, given the dynamics at play on the ground in Myanmar, you know, and we are talking here about intensification in conflict, not only in ethnic areas, but even in urban centers. We are talking about the increase in COVID cases. We are talking about the economy contracting by more than 10%, and all of these factors adding up. And so I think really a key concern at the moment is how not to make a bad situation worse, right? And how not to do more harm by trying to do good. And again, I think I don't have the solution. I don't think anyone does really. Because one of the key issues there is what is the Achilles heel of the military that can be targeted through sanctions or other means in such a way that they decide that it's too much pain and they indeed need to turn things around. And frankly, I think that Achilles heel, where it is and how it can be targeted, I think it's still to be found if it exists in the first place. And so that means the struggle it will be very protracted, as it already is, with significant impact on the Myanmar population. And here, the impact will be borne mostly by the poorest and most vulnerable Myanmar people. And so, you know, again, dilemmas. And so that brings me to the last point, which is businesses. What can businesses do? What can they do? And I think here, I think there are expectations which are valid completely, you know, in terms of abiding by high standards when it comes to compliance or business and human rights. But at the same time, we need to be realistic as to what businesses can achieve and also the risks that they are facing. I mentioned about security risks. And I think, you know, if you are a Myanmar business person, you can be arrested or imprisoned, or and your family too. Meaning the type of human rights abuses that the military regime engages in against media, journalists, civil society actors, business people can also be exposed to them. And including at the moment, foreign investors. We saw that with the telecom situation. And I think, you know, when it comes to the debate on withholding taxes from the oil and gas sector, you know, whether to sanction MOG, et cetera, I think it's a valid concern when foreign oil and gas companies operating in Myanmar say, well, if we come under certain measures that could put our staff on the ground at risk. So again, I don't have solutions, sadly, but I think these dilemmas are very important to be kept in mind and to be part of the discussion as we try to seek a way forward for Myanmar.
Thank you very much. I think now the time is also very fast. Do we have another round question? Do you think, or shall we?
Yeah, I think if we could have one more round, because I didn't take some major parts.
Very briefly, yes.
Okay, yes. So
I think a bit prolonged, maybe 10 minutes or so, yeah.
Okay, so one part of the questions that are addressed by many of the the people were about the minorities. So what do you assess, how do you assess the prospect of protecting human security of all the people of Myanmar, including minorities, including Shan and Rohingya people? That's one area. I think there was a lengthy comment also. I think you have seen it. Another part is sort of a series of comments and questions about the prospect of having a meaningful consultation. So one person asked, if good faith can be expected in the negotiation. Another person brought in the perspective of armed control. So when there is support from outside to provide arms to military, what is the prospect of peace? Another person is slightly different in the support from another country, other countries, I guess, including Russia, they say. What do you think of the prospect of peace in that? So I think maybe related to that is this question that just came in. It was about the power of NUG and military. So because of this realistic picture of power distribution, what do you think is a prospect of moving forward for peace? I think maybe that's the big part of the question.
Okay, if possible, could you, Nemoto-sensei can lead a very brief answer if you can regarding this?
Yes. Yeah. Let me talk in Japanese once again. すみません、日本語で説明いたします。少数民族問題、特にロヒンギャのことが注目されてますが、今回のクーデターとその後の状況を見てますと、ミャンマーの国民全体が被害者であることはもちろんなんですけれども、その中で特に被害の度合いが強いのが、バングラデシュの難民キャンプにいるロヒンギャたちと、それからラカイン州に残されているロヒンギャですね、まあ、実際難民キャンプのところに入れられてしまっている国内のロヒンギャがいます。で、NUG はですね、少数民族との、公平な連帯、公正な連帯ということに一番力を入れてまして、ロヒンギャも仲間に入れるということを明言しています。ですから少し先行きは明るくなったようにも思うんですが、問題はミャンマーの国内の世論にあります。NUG のそのロヒンギャ受け入れに賛成する人たちは増えてはいますけども、やりすぎだという人もいるんですね。ただここはよく見えてこないんですね。この先ロヒンギャをミャンマーの国民の多数派が、その仏教徒のバマーと呼ばれる人たちがどこまでロヒンギャに対して、受け入れる立場になっていくか、そこがまだ見極めがついてないということを言います。それから他の少数民族との連帯の問題ですが、 NUG に、いわば素直に連帯する少数民族政治組織、軍事組織と、それから距離を置いているグループがあります。そしてまた質問者の中にご指摘があったように、少数民族軍事勢力同士がぶつかっている事例もあるんですね。したがってこれも一筋縄ではいかない。ただNUG に責任があるんだと、NUG にも責任があるんだという質問がありましたけども、私はそうは見ないんですね。NUG はやはりまだ実効支配という点では何もできてないわけですから、NUG に少数民族同士のぶつかり合いの責任を課す、責任を求めるというのは間違っていると思う。NUG はやはり今後の見通しをはっきりとミャンマー国民に示しながら、少しずつ実効支配を目指すと、そういう立場にあるとしてます。とりあえず以上です。
Maiko-san, do you have anything?
Sure. Well, because I also talked about the Rohingya issue well, in my presentation, so I just want to add to what Nemoto-sensei beautifully explained. There's not much that I can add to the domestic side, but the reason why I focused, brought up the Rohingya issue was because it was one of the attention issue from the Western countries. And I didn't mean that, I was ignoring the rights of other ethnic minorities. I wanted to be clear about that. And in order for CDM to sustain itself and succeed in getting back the country, it for sure needs external support. And as I said in my presentation, the current NUG's approach of emphasizing the human rights and democracy, those values, by including Rohingya people in in their conception using the term, those approaches, also as Professor Nemoto talked about, seems a right approach in organizing support from external countries. So, as Nemoto-sensei talked about, what we have to worry about is how we can, NUG can orchestrate domestic support for that. And I believe that there are those Myanmar people who are attending the seminar today. And so I really want to encourage you all, those Myanmar people, to think about, how to treat Rohingya and other ethnic minorities in your countries, especially have to think about the way to give citizenship to Rohingya as a way to proceed as a democratic country.
Thank you, Evan and Romain. If you have any, yes.
Sure. Let me talk about the good faith part a bit, because I think this ties to ASEAN's 5-point consensus. When we first discussed, before the ASEAN leaders meeting, when we discussed the outcomes that we wanted to propose, the central feature of the three outcomes, the cessation of violence, aid delivery, and dialogue, we had discussed it as a sequential part. Why? Because we know that good faith on both sides is not there at all. Which is why in the three outcomes it wanted to propose, the idea is to first stop the violence, which would be necessary for us to deliver aid. But in combination, the cessation of aid and the delivery, the cessation of violence and the delivery of aid was initially conceived as a way to create the necessary political and humanitarian space to explore that dialogue process, which is why it'll be unfortunate if it's broken apart into separate lines of effort, aid without ending violence or aid without the political dialogue, because the idea was that there is no dialogue, or at least we think at that point in time, there is never gonna be dialogue without violence being stopped and without aid being delivered. So, this idea seemed reasonable 2-3 months ago, but obviously things have changed very quickly over the last 3 months that I'm afraid the reasoning or the logic behind the 5-point consensus may be obsolete by this month. But at that point, precisely because we knew perfectly that there was no faith, good faith, that we have to create the space necessary, which is why we preface the engagement with cessation of violence and aid delivery. So it is to some extent, unfortunately, being seen by my friends in the humanitarian side as politicizing aid delivery. But at that point in time, we didn't have much of a choice. If there is no ending of violence and there is no aid delivery, there is no space necessary for dialogue. So I think while we can think of non-ASEAN options to get there, I think the same logic remains, which is if there is no cessation of violence and if aid doesn't get delivered, there is never going to be space necessary for both sides to meet. And this is my worry, I guess. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Romain-san, you have?
Yeah, I'll add to the topic of ethnic diversity and how it impacts the private sector. I mean, Myanmar is a very complex place with a history of civil war in multiple parts of the country. And of course, what's happening now is making things much worse. But my point is that while already before the coup, it was essential for all companies, including Japanese, to really be sensitive to the context and to understand the history, the ethnic diversity, all the issues that they are faced with when they operate in such a place. And my concern moving forward, at least in the coming months or years, depending on how long this crisis gets, is that possibly the new actors that I mentioned will be benefiting from the crisis, sadly, will be much less conflict sensitive than those prior to the coup. And here I'll give an example in relation to the hydropower sector. So French utilities, EDF, had entered into a partnership with a Japanese trading house, Marubeni, together with a local company to develop a mid-size power dam near in northern Shan state, near the border with China. Again, I mean, Myanmar has an electricity supply problem, and so that's where they were coming in. And since following the coup, they announced, so EDF and Marubeni, that they will be suspending their project because obviously, especially in a place like northern Shan state, which people attending and we know is a very complex from a conflict and ethnic diversity perspective. And of course, you've got drugs and the illegal narco economy and the rest and mining, et cetera. So already it was a very challenging place to operate. And they said that given the new circumstances in Myanmar, they will not be able to proceed with the project in a way that would meet their international business and human rights and compliance standards. Mm-hmm. I mean, when you have to relocate, acquire land, relocate populations, the situation in Myanmar is just not, makes it just impossible. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, we've seen since the coup in the hydropower sector, the new authorities, the military regime, mentioned that they were considering resuming large-scale hydro projects. So they are concerned around the Mison Dam in Kachin State, which had been suspended by President Thein Sein, and that was a gesture that was then seen as a very symbolic move that Myanmar was moving towards political and economic reforms. So there has been, we don't know about Mison, this hasn't been mentioned, but one project that has been mentioned, and Mison involves China. And another project that has been mentioned by name, this one, is the Haji Dam on the Salween River, which involves Thailand. And so again, we shall see whether these mega projects resume. But here to conclude, this is what worries me really about where things are going. It's a situation similar to pre-2011, where the economic and business actors in this political economy are not good ones. And the gains of the last decade are eroded little by little. And of course, the blame there goes fully to the military regime that has really put an end to a transition that I think was benefiting a lot of Myanmar people, despite, of course, the remaining challenges such as the Rohingya crisis and many other such issues in Myanmar.
Well, thank you very much, Romain Fan. Fortunately, the time is up now, but if you allow me, I'd like to extend 10 minutes or so. And then I have one guest, in fact, the person in the missing in this program, because Zima Aung San is not participating. So that is a Myanmar civilian who actually want some message. Indra San. Can you join the mute you can just speak maybe a few minutes? Yes. Yes, please. Self-introduction first. In Japanese, so please, the person who cannot understand Japanese, please turn the simultaneous interpretation of the English. Yes. So, Endra-san, 日本語でどうぞ。はい。自己紹介からどうぞ。
まあ、本日はこのような場でお話をさせていただいてありがとうございます。今私は日本の大学院で、メディカルエンジニアリングを研究しています。限られた時間ですので、私からは、今回の皆さんのお話を聞いて、安全保障の観点から今のミャンマーの市民が直面している危機について少しだけお話しさせていただければと思います。今ですね、ミャンマーは安全保障以前に人権侵害を受けている状況なので、まあ、人権侵害はちょっと私たち市民からはどうにも動くことはできない。これは政府や国連の皆様方に、お願いする立場ではあるんですけれども、で安全保障の点では何かできることはないかなと私自身は、いつも思っていることではあります。でそこで、人間の安全保障っていうのは何かというものを調べたときに、日本の外務省のウェブにはですね、人間一人一人に着目して、生存生活尊厳に対する広範かつ深刻な脅威から人々を守り、でそれぞれの持つ豊かな可能性を実現するために保護と能力強化を通じて持続可能な個人の自立と社会づくりを促す考え方というふうに書いてありました。でこの文章を見て、今のミャンマーの状況を見ますと、でミャンマーにおける今安全保障がされていない期間は2年目になると思います。で1年目はですね、2020年、ミャンマーで初めて COVID-19 感染者が発見された翌日から、もうすべての学校が学級閉鎖になり、すべての多くの町でロックダウンが次々と始まりました。その結果、企業の経営が大きく傾き、従業員の給料も下がり、第1のピンチといいますか、それはミャンマーでありました。今私自身学生なので、まあ、たくさんの視点あると思うんですが、ミャンマーの学生の視点に絞って今日はお話をさせていただきますと、学級閉鎖になって一番最初に直面した問題はですね、大学に入学できないというものと大学を卒業できないというのが学生の間で大きな問題でした。でそれを考慮して、その時の政府は、まあ、新卒の就職が困難になるのでは困ると、まあね、国の将来も困るということなので、大学の最終学年卒業生だけ、卒業論文のためにオンラインで授業をやっていました。まあ、そして1年耐えて今年こそ通常通り授業ができるかなという時にクーデターが起きまして、今度は学校に行くこと自体が安全ではないということになったんですね。で今でもその大学含め全てのミャンマーの学校は、学級閉鎖になったままです。でそれによって今ミャンマーの学生は2年間時間を無駄にしました。でそしてそうなると海外に留学するにもその国の言語や金銭問題、そして年齢、大学卒業生にもなるともう年齢が22、23超えてますので、今から1年生として再入学することもできず、でそこでさらに追い打ちをかけるように各国の制裁によって、そのミャンマーから Google などへのアクセスが停止されてしまったんですね。なので行動したくても行動できない状態が今ミャンマーの若者の間で起きています。でどうすればいいかっていうのもわからない。で今 NUG が、NUG の教育省の下で、まあ、オンラインで勉強を再スタートするも、果たしてこれが正式な学位卒業として認められるかどうかという不安な声も出ています。で最近では、まあ、日本の企業も撤退、日本の企業の撤退とかもあり、そのミャンマーの就職困難がよりひどい状況になっています。でそこで、あもう今始まっている COVID-19 の第3波が連日多くの死者を続出させています。今国の情勢上、医師も治療を隠れてしざるを得ない状況にもあって、この第3波を乗り切るっていうのがとても難しい状況です。でそしてワクチン不足であってもすごく高価で裕福な人しか受けられない。でその中でも数がとても少ないので、いくらお金があってもワクチン受けられない、そういうこともあります。で最近では、病床の、不足でもう道路で酸素マックス をつけて道路に放置されているような患者も見られます。今市民の間では貧困の差、そして、戦争の避難地での、飢えだったり餓死だったり、そういう差がとっても大きくなっています。でそれがですね、このまま続いていくと、もちろん学業困難、失業、職業、職業困難が増えていて、人として生活を維持すること自体がとても難しくなっています。今 CDM の方々にも生活を保障することが難しい状態で、民間企業などでもそういう失業だったり、もう生活維持ができないというふうな人が出た場合、もうミャンマー国全体の生活が崩れ落ちる事態になるかもしれないです。まあ、そういった事態から少しでも助けられるよう、助けになれるように、日本の皆さん、世界の皆さんにはいろいろ協力をしてもらっているんですが、私自身としては、まあ、ミャンマーから来日したい学生の支援と、日本企業でのミャンマー人の雇用をお願いして、お願いをしたり、活動している部分はあります。今回今さまざまな方がこういった、場所にいらっしゃって、皆さんの話を聞いてくださったり、いろいろ考えてくださっているので、一市民の声ですが参考までに聞いて、でミャンマーの人々の安全保障のうち生活や、自立の面で何かお力をいただければ嬉しく思います。本日はありがとうございました。
Well, thank you very much for your intervention. We appreciate theBut same time, be very careful for your security where you're wondering. We appreciate your
message.
Yes. Fortunately, it's already 8 past 1 p.m., so we have to wrap up, unfortunately. As I mentioned, this will be recorded and then after editing, we should be open for the public view. And then I think also after this symposium, our students ask the audience to answer the survey. So this survey is a very crucial for us, our organizer, to work for a future following up of this symposium and to human security in Myanmar and Asia. So now I will ask Hoshino sensei for the closing remark. You are here or cannot see? Yes, please.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, so hello everybody. My name is Moriyuki Hoshino. I am the director of the graduate program of human security in the University of Tokyo, called briefly HSP. It is my pleasure to be here taking part in this symposium and to make just a short speech to close it. I will be very short. Until now, our program has organized many seminars and symposiums focusing on human security issues. And I think that the present symposium is one of the most important among all, as the situation of crisis in Myanmar now is one of the most serious challenges to the notion of human security itself. As we can see more clearly now, many people in Myanmar under the conflict and under the pandemic of COVID-19 in addition, are suffering fear, want, and violence. I know that there is no magic solution to this situation, and that it may need a long process to restore the peace and realize freedom from fear, freedom from want, and freedom to live in dignity. But I believe that our gathering here now can be a sign of hope. Maybe just a small step, but certainly one step ahead. Finally, I'd like to express my feeling of gratitude toward all the speakers, participants, and supporting organizations. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Hoshino, the director of the HSP. Now everything is now completed, but as I told you, the this is not the end of the this project. I think kind of we are challenging the sort of a new era for HSP's agenda for human security, especially in Myanmar, is a very urgent matter. But of course, refugees are actually increasing. Number of the refugees are actually increasing, and UNHCR data also says more than 80 million people are now in concern of the this HS United Nations, and United Nations 2018 adopted a very significant historic instrument, the Global Compact on Refugees. And in this document, it's a kind of paradigm shift from not only the international organization government to be responsible for this humanitarian matters, refugees, so on. That is non-state actors, such as civil societies, private sectors, because we are the same globalization. We share the responsibility. Specifically, academia, we are also addressed the global network, academic network, for address these issues. This is an urgent issue, but also very profound analysis and studying for the future. I think refugees and also Myanmar issues is very difficult to solve at once. Of course, it takes a long time, but we believe in the future. The future is constructed by young people like Endra-san, or the students, to learn in Japan and also some Japanese students all over the world. So students are our hope for the future. We believe in some future successful democracy in Myanmar, human security. We are working for this future. So please join us for applaud of all the participants and the audiences. Then please answer your sort of quite comments and the survey we are just providing by the students. We collect it and feedback the data. So we also consider how to take next step forward. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for everyone for joining, and sorry for the time bit extended. Thank you very much, Endra-san. Thank you very much, Dean Professor Morishima-san, and also Director and the Hoshino-san, also all the panelists, Nemoto-san and Ichihara-san, also the Laxmana-san, also the Romaine-san, and then also the all the staff, in fact. Unfortunately, Zima Amin-san was not present, but I believe she is, of course, sharing idea in the future. We will invite again future, same as we invited Madam Aung San Suu Kyi 2013. If you didn't see it, please see it. Our TV, TV University Tokyo TV is a release this very historic significant voice from the Madam Aung San Suu Kyi. She's now voiceless, and so we would listen to the voiceless peoples. So that is our role of the academia. Thank you very much. Thank you. See you again.